is it what crazy or tall crazy or what type of crazy is that except crazy?
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, tribal looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to disrepute. I said, oh, hell
on
me.
Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
You're welcome back, and you're still on to Core TV News Lagos, and it's our current affairs program, ever steamy participatory Core Digest. I've now been joined by the full complement of my guests, and from my immediate left, we both reviewed the papers, IFEOMA ISEH. IFEOMA, thanks again for being with us. And I have a legal icon here, or iconoclast. Let me just start calling her there, you know. Peace, Uju, Peace, Okeke. She's a legal practitioner. You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Good morning, viewers.
All right. We told you earlier, or rather I told you earlier, that I'll be bringing you a video clip from CNN. It's an exclusive footage. But we leave it for you to judge if that footage is recently or if it's some 2 years ago. Let's take a clip about the 15 Chibok girls who were interviewed, courtesy of CNN.
Lined up against a yellow wall, 15 girls, only their faces showing. An off-camera voice asks each girl, "What's your name?" Is that the name your parents recognize? Where were you taken from, the voice asks. Chibok School, and the date they say is the 25th of December, 2015. This video was obtained by CNN from a person close to the negotiations to get these girls released. For the parents, it's finally a glimmer of hope these girls are still alive. Two years ago, we met Mary Ashaya, Rifkatu Ayuba, and Yala Galang on our visit to Chibok after the abduction of their daughters and more than 200 other girls. We asked them if they recognize any of the girls in the video. They lean closer. Another girl is identified, Hawa. One by one, they name all 15 girls. But one mother, Yala, realizes her daughter isn't there. The off-camera voice asking the questions is familiar to CNN as that of Boko Haram spokesman Abu Zinara. A source close to negotiations between Boko Haram and the Nigerian government said the video was provided by the terror group as an asked-for show of good faith. Nigeria's information minister told CNN they have received the video, but are still reviewing it.
If you study the video, you find that the questions were asked in a rather very controlled environment. Then we were a bit concerned, too, that after 2 years in captivity, the girls in the video were under no stress whatsoever. There has been little or no transformation to their physical appearance.
Is your government negotiating with Boko Haram for the release of these girls?
Well, there are ongoing talks. We cannot ignore offers. We cannot ignore leads. But of course, many of these investigations cannot be disclosed, you know, openly, because it could also endanger, you know, the negotiations.
We took the video to a classmate of the Chibok girls. She'd been at home with family the day the other girls were kidnapped. For her safety, we're not showing her face, and not using her name. She told us there's no doubt these are some of her kidnapped classmates.
These two were prefects. Watching the video, I'm reminded of how we used to play together, how we used to do chores, do our homework.
She says seeing her friends again will likely give her nightmares.
Sometimes still, if I hear news about them, I have bad dreams and I wake up crying.
The video ends with a girl addressing the camera with a message to the Nigerian government. We are all well, she says pointedly, perhaps suggesting girls not seen in this video. She then delivers what sounds like a scripted plea, urging the Nigerian government to fulfill unspecified promises. For the mothers of these girls rapidly becoming women far from home, the video is overwhelming. They say they just want someone to bring their daughters home. Nemal Bagir, CNN, Maiduguri, Nigeria.
All right, welcome back. I'm sure you must have formed your own impression there watching that exclusive video obtained from CNN. We want to thank them especially for that, you know, showing some of our girls again. But let me start with Madam Ife. It's 2 years on that these innocent girls were taken away, not to be seen again.
It's pathetic. When the news filtered out in 2014, many people did not believe because of the number of people who they said they were who were kidnapped away from school. Some of us said 300 and something. How did they pick those girls? It was a question we have to ask. I went to a boarding school. My gate is very far from the hostel. It's like you're walking almost a mile before you come into the
dormitory.
Not the dormitary,
even the classroom area, the academic area.
Before the dormitory at the back of the classrooms. Mm. So we were imagining, we said, 300 and. No. Some of us didn't believe it. Until they said some of the guys ran away from
the abductors.
About 50 something of them. We started thinking, I said, if a large number of children, daughters like that, move away, what is the government doing about it? What did the government do? Why didn't they at least, you know, show
act
resistance? Yes, show resistance. Where are you taking these girls? Are there nobody in the local government? They move from one community to community that makes up a local government. Nobody say, please, oh, they are taking so-and-so girls away, even if it was in the midnight. There must be some noises here and there that you want to peep and say, oh, what is happening? Nobody could say anything. Many people thought it was one of those...
The political hoax.
Yes, yeah. They just say flyer. They just fly it, let them say, oh, this and that. But as time goes on...
It became reality.
It became kind of, is it true? Is it not true? Even up to yesterday, Christian, you know, you tried to talk to me. And it was an in-depth thought throughout yesterday. Will these children come back with what? You are kind of giving me an eyewitness report. I can't just imagine any of my children, any of my daughters disappearing. Even when they don't even come back early, when they go out or from work, you as a mother, you're already worried. You try to be using your phone to locate them. Not to talk of somebody that will just come one day, you just go to the hostel, pack everybody, boom, and off you go. Without knowledge of where that child is going, it's very traumatic.
Yeah, quite traumatic indeed. You as a lawyer, as a rights activist, you know, a female too. 2 years, do you think government is done enough, you know, to getting these girls back? Haven't they gathered enough intelligence from even the 57 of them that they said escaped, you know, on the night of the abduction and some other subsequently?
Thank you. Personally, I don't think government is doing enough. You see, I want to start from the angle of education, the importance of education. It was Nelson Mandela that said that education is the greatest weapon with which you should change the world. And here in this part of the world, we are crying. We are asking for gender parity. How do we get gender parity if women don't go to school? Now these girls, they've gone to school in a federal government school, in the custody of federal government, and they were abducted. You see, for me, it's a failure, total failure of the institutions. Because you remember Nigeria, that we have what we call the Child's Rights Act.
Yeah.
If you look at
Some states have not signed.
No, but we have.
So, nationally, yes.
If you look at Section 15 of that act, it talks about rights of children. Of course, you know, a child is anybody below the age of 18.
18, yeah.
So, universal primary education, not secondary education, compulsory basic education. Now, these girls are getting this education. And while in this education, Section 16 also talks about right to protection. In other words, it means that because they were in boarding school, they needed protection of government. That was where the government failed. Because if they had that protection, they wouldn't have been abducted. Okay, now what has happened has happened. This is 2 years down the line. Mm-hmm. And we keep hearing stories. I have a serious issue with that. Because, okay, recently we heard of parents that say that they were called with their children's number. Now, what information are we looking for? For goodness sake, for me, I think this is where discrimination comes in, which is contrary to Section 42 of the Constitution. Because, okay, for assuming that this thing happened in Abuja, one of those big schools, elite schools, are you telling me that 2 years down the line, the girls will still be there?
Like the one we saw in Ikorodu? And in less than a fortnight,
the fourth day they were released,
they picked everybody involved.
There are some schools that are bigger than the one in Ikorodu, some bigger schools in Abuja. If something like this would have happened there, I'm sure by now I'll be telling a different story. Because this brings mind, this is basically purely discrimination, because they are Chibok girls, because they are daughters, children of poor people.
Local
for goodness sake, it doesn't make sense to me. This is a breakdown of institution, and government should be careful, because if government is silently sending a message that we really don't care about the poor people, something is about to give. It doesn't make sense. If it's the rich, he gets all the attention. If it's the poor, he doesn't get all the attention.
My worry here is that a lot of conjectures were, you know, put up even when these girls were abducted. You know, for example, it was alleged that 4 hours before the abduction, before the kidnap, the military had the intelligence report to have saved the situation and rescued some of them. Yeah, that is the $1 million, you know, question begging to be answered. But when you put it side by side with comments from elder statesman and ex-president Chief Olusegun Obasanjo, who said the children are gone forever. Do you still nurse or keep hope alive, as the vice president has said only yesterday?
Well, I'm still hopeful. Seriously hopeful. Seriously hopeful. For the sake of these girls, for the sake of Nigeria itself. Because it sends a wrong signal. I'm still very, very hopeful. And I pray these girls come back. Sincerely speaking, very, very hopeful. But then, even though we are hopeful, we need to take action. That's where I think that government isn't. Government should sit up. Government should sit up. Okay, like we had in the news that as of January, a committee was reconstituted. Till date, we don't know what has happened to the committee. How far have they gone
to do what?
To investigate into the kidnap. But till date, we don't know what has happened. Okay, have they what have they come up with? Have they completed investigations?
Listen. I think there's something they call investigative journalism. I don't know why our journalists have not given us the true story of these Chibok girls.
If you watch true story, I'd said it here on this program, Times Without Number. I was in Konduga and Bama 1 year ago, over one year ago. That's when the Nigerian army liberated Bama, the then Islamic Republic of the Boko Haram.
We all saw that on TV.
Yes, and I was there. So, and I know the investigation we did. I know how the military at that time, you know, wanted certain things expunged. Mm-hmm. And I said it here. Go to the well in Bama prison is more than 1,000 meters deep. That's about a kilometer. And loads and loads, hundreds of people were killed and dumped in that well.
So,
have they retrieved? So go on. I'm putting up a defense for the Nigerian journalists. You get the point.
Well,
and how many of them have insurance? To go to a war situation.
Like a war front.
It's a war front.
It's a systemic disaster.
The systemic failure. Because the federal government, Uju, you said the federal, it wasn't the federal school, it was a state school, I suppose.
It was a government school.
Government school.
It was a state government school.
Government secondary school, Chibok.
It's not a federal government school. But all the same, all of us are under the federal government.
Exactly.
So we must be protected. I couldn't just imagine myself as a naughty iffy in the 70s. And somebody will now come and lure me away from the school in the dormitory. Take me to where? It's appalling. I want to buttress what Uju is saying.
Yeah.
The government's primary duty is to save us lives, people before property.
That is it.
Property, you can get property if you have life. But when you are gone forever. Are you talking about property with life? The primary duty of any government, local government, state government, federal government, is to take care of us.
If you let me help you put it. If you look at section 14 of the constitution, the purpose of government is welfare and security. Welfare and security.
So, but where government has failed in this area, what would the parents have done? Sue the government?
Yeah, we will sue the government. I personally, for my, will sue the government. They must produce my daughter. That is in the boarding house. I will sue that government.
Exactly.
I will not take that nonsense from them. They are not looking at them because these people are, you know, people who are farmers who farm and bring food to us down to Lagos. No way. You can't take my daughter under your own protest, under your own word. Oh, Mbano. I will take that. I might not have one couple. Would you? You might be of help to us. Then we will go to the court. That state government, Kashima, what is the man's name?
Kashim
will give me my daughter. If not, I will sue him to his last company's treasure. That is what these people are not doing. You can't just. What were you doing? And it took you so long, 18, 19 days, to even inform the federal government that, they've stolen children on my head, though. What is that? Was there acrimony? Was there malice between you and the president that you couldn't pass information to him as quickly as you can? That same minute you had it, you must make a move. This one, you say, make a con tell me now. And I'm going to con tell, I ain't not here. That is the situation. And before you know it, the thing went out of hand.
They played Donju politics?
Yes.
That's what informs my position that government isn't doing enough.
Yes.
Because, for instance, even the parents are not being carried along.
Yeah.
You see, when things like this happen, Parents need to be briefed intermittently.
Yeah.
Hold meetings with them, because whether you like it or you like it, they are traumatized. A lot of them have died.
Some of them have died.
A lot of them have died, if not all.
And nothing is happening. Nobody is doing anything about that.
Then you will pay me, oh.
No, that's not right.
You will pay for damages.
That's not right.
And for taking my daughter's life. Because those children, it's not from only Chibok, that government school.
No, they came from surrounding villages. Yeah.
To go and do a course, a subject exam.
Physics.
Yeah, physics. So, at what point did the government relegate duties to Boko Haram? And you had the information 4 hours before that time. You didn't make any move.
In this matter, even where both of you say the Nigerian government has failed, has the international community helped? Because only a couple of weeks ago, the British High Commissioner to Nigeria, Sir Andrew Pocock, had said that they had spotted, you know, the American eye in the sky technology had spotted some of the Chibok girls, but they couldn't, you know, move in. Because of maybe the collateral, that it would have resulted. We've heard the former chief of defense staff too, then, who is facing trial now, saying that, oh, they've spotted the girls, oh, the girls will come back, oh, they are going to negotiate and the rest. But has the international community really helped in this matter?
Personally, I don't think so.
They've not.
But the truth is, charity begins at home. It's our thing. Yes, much as we need help from them, it is our fight. You know, we have to start the fight and then they will help us. You don't want to help somebody and the person isn't doing anything and you come to do all the job. Mm. It doesn't make sense.
No, because the ex-president had wanted to negotiate, you know, the release of the Chibok girls with the Boko Haram.
But they told the ex-president not to do that.
That's what I'm saying. Yes. Yeah.
They are the same people. So where do we place all their help? It's neither here or there. Are you telling me that if those Chibok girls, let's say 5 British people are there,
exactly,
and 5 French people are there, and maybe 2 Americans, they will leave them? An American that can die for one soul, they will leave them in whatever they say, their eagle eye saw them, a blue sky eye. What do you say?
I think that's where we need to be decisive as a nation.
Yes.
We need to be. Okay, for instance.
Then why didn't they bring, they should have done something to help those children. They can't be telling us that you cited them because your people are not there. It's not right.
Maybe they're also looking at us and they're thinking we are not serious. It's also possible. Because I'm sure if it happened in their climb,
they
have done something. Yes. So maybe they're also thinking we are not serious. It's possible. For instance, I can't come to your house to help you. Maybe your house is on fire and you're not making any effort, you're not doing anything. I can't just come and carry your body. I can't come and carry your cross. As you're carrying your cross, I help you with your cross. But if you refuse to carry your cross entirely, what do I do? Do I pick the cross from the floor? Remember, I'm carrying mine. Do I pick your cross from the floor and also carry mine and carry yours as well? Then I could give you a helping hand when you're carrying yours. So maybe they're looking at us and they're thinking we are not serious. It's possible.
Our government had to do something.
And if you think we're not serious?
We're not serious. If we are serious, even one could have even rescued one to come and tell the story. Every time you keep saying 276 girls.
Some escaped of their own volition, and they've given us information.
No, those ones that escaped, we understand that when they were going, that was when they.
No, not only when they were going. Some jumped, some escaped from the camp. Initially from Chibok, they were said to have been taken to Konduga, you know, apparently to the headquarters of Boko Haram, because between Konduga and Bama. Is less than 15-20 kilometers.
Okay.
It's less than 15. And that's you know, the beginning of the stretch of the Sambisa forest. You get the point. It starts from Maiduguri, like a grassland, you know, with shrubs. And gradually, when you're moving to Taraba, Adamawa, and the rest, you have the Cameroonian mountain vegetations and the rest, and it becomes thick in some areas and the rest. So It's not like our own mangrove swamp forest, anyway, yeah. You know. But okay, let's take a short break and take some messages. And when we return, we'll still be looking at the abduction of the Chibok girls. Are they still alive? Join us again.
Every day, every hour, and every minute, news break in Nigeria. Things happen so fast, it's most times difficult to track and comprehend them. But that's what we do right here on Digi 360.
2015, would you want to come back again?
It's like asking Jesus Christ if he knew he was going to die, will you come? Will you want to come back as the savior of the world again?
We do not just help you track the stories, we break them down, explore all the angles, analyze the issues so that you can fully comprehend the stories and use them to make the right decisions.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook. And YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV. Leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station. Core TV News now live on all Androids.
Welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
Download Core TV News app from your Play Store. Click on the menu to see all our top stories from politics, sports, business, foreign news, and live TV to watch us live on your mobile.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
You can also click on video to see all our YouTube videos. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.
For topical issues, Nigerians must have something to say.
Arms, we don't need arms for anything. Let them put it into education.
They need to buy another arms now.
What are they fighting for?
Government should deal with them squarely.
Please help us bring back our girls.
No money, no markets. We are dying. Everybody is crying. Nothing, nothing.
Any man God support, no man stops.
It's a prophecy I believe he must have received from heaven. Yes.
The people giving voice to the voiceless.
Is it what crazy? Or talk crazy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, driving looters. That are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Excuse me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to discipline.
I said, help me.
On Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
Welcome back. You're still on to Core Digest, and we're still looking 2 years after the abduction of the Chibok girls. Are they still alive? And I was brought back my guest on the issue of elder statesman, president, ex-president Chief Olusegun Obasanjo, when he said a couple of weeks ago or months ago that we should forget about the Chibok girls, that they are gone forever. I said, is that statemanly? Is that is there any truism to that?
Well, knowing what who our former president is, Baba Obasanjo, he doesn't care who else is
God.
He will say it as it is. It could be painful, it could be sorrowful. But that is his findings or observation. Well, how would I do, to say, oh, we have to tell these people They should just take it as if you have buried your daughters. And to be honest with you, I want to kind of turn, follow his path. If those girls are alive, there's no way you can keep all those girls in one place. That some of them will say, okay, Amina or Sarah, go and fetch water. Or go, are they not sending them messages? Or they just sit down and the Boko Haram boys will go and just come and sleep with them, give them food. They don't send them message out of that enclave. Because some of us, we have, when we were keeping maids, maids will come. You might send one of them and say, ah, okay, come and go and grind pepper. Before you know it, you and your pepper. That child will not come back. He has escaped. Then you'll be waiting. Ah, why is this person not bringing back the grinded pepper now? By the time you know you go to the grinding pepper place, he has dropped your pepper and run away. Come and go to the market. Are they not going to markets? They don't send them out of that enclave. Because keeping 276 children, there's no way they would have escaped. It's hard to say, but it's the truth. I feel those girls are no more alive.
If I choose to disagree with you.
Well, because that's my own opinion.
Yes, much as I want to respect the person of our former president, but for me, I think he's no longer in charge. He may not have the information that this current regime has. It's possible, very, very possible. And then are you now telling me this year, 2016, some parents said, in fact, at least a parent said, he was called with her child, with his child's number, with his daughter's number. And then when they called back, a man picked and said, the owner of this phone is my wife. For goodness sake, for me, I strongly believe they are alive.
And the security, and that number is not traced to the security agencies and the rest?
Well, I wouldn't know. I don't work with security agencies.
Okay.
But we saw it in the, at least I saw it in the, this way, I saw the news. I saw the story. And for me, the question that also came to me was, so what are security agencies doing with this kind of news?
And the video we saw earlier, you know, I don't know if it can be played back again, Uju, underscore it, because I remembered before, you know, the program we started the discourse, you had said, look, those girls could have even be, you know, totally reorientated. That's why you have that strong belief about. So
it's about brainwashing, because if you follow what ISIS does with girls, even the girls that voluntarily go to join ISIS, many of them that escape, they tell us their stories, or what we read about their stories, of what it's about total brainwashing. So if we, even though these guys, even if they send it, maybe they've told them all out of lies, this is the best place to be, you know, from here you go to heaven, Nigerians, they are sinners, and all that kind of thing. You know, for 2 years you keep brainwashing somebody, it's possible the person doesn't even believe in Nigeria anymore. And then they keep telling the person, oh, your government doesn't believe in you, they don't think you're worth anything, you know, that kind of thing. So they sell them all out of lies. So even when they have opportunity, some of them may not want to come back. Except some people. You know, sincerely speaking, it's about being watching. If what is being watching? What is being watching? For instance, you keep somebody even for 2 months, keep somebody indoors, tell the person every morning and every night you can't amount to anything. After 2 months, the person doesn't think the person will be anything anymore. It's about being watching issue. So I think, sincerely speaking, I strongly believe these girls are alive. Going by the news we hear every day, going by the video we just saw, going by this news of a father receiving a phone call on the girl's number, I think they are alive. It's just that we've not done enough.
Why would you now, why would Boko Haram, you know, be keeping these girls up till now?
I'm not a member of Boko Haram.
How would I do?
Because you see, for me, Uju, I think that, you know, we have a whole lot of people with warped mentalities, warped mentality out there. A whole lot of people thinking rubbish, you know, so you don't even know what they are thinking, you know, thinking they are doing the right thing. But you see, Christian, that comes back to where I think we failed. Education. For goodness sake, I can never overflow the issue of education in Nigeria. We can never. That is the greatest weapon which we can change Nigeria.
Nigeria.
Even our young boys, whether you like it or you like it, some young boys will be thinking that this Boko Haram, they are heroes. They want to grow to be like
even
them.
Even the Boko Haram people, they want to give yes. them a loan for entrepreneurship.
I'm telling you the truth. So how do
we'll
we
go and collect money?
How do we leave this in the boy? How do we leave this in the boy? Education. Education. Section 15 of the Child's Rights Act. Let us begin to implement it. We can never overemphasize it. It is very, very important. Education, especially in the rural areas. Let us make it compulsory, like the law says. Let it be basic, let it be qualitative. And then you see, we begin to, that's also brainwashing. We begin to brainwash. Yes, yeah. The minds of our
young people. Another angle of brainwashing.
Yes, but that is the positive of brainwashing.
Yeah, positive that brainwashing.
We can't overemphasize it. Mm. So that's where I think that government is failing. Because even with all this, what has happened with our educational system? Sincerely speaking, well, it's a story for another day.
Yeah.
But that's where I keep saying, it doesn't matter what we say, it doesn't matter where we go. I come back to the system. I come back to the government. Because you're not doing the primary things. Okay, for instance, let me ask you, Christian, let me tell you what we are doing. It's just like you're in a house, your child defecates in the house, and you don't clean it up. Mm. You now buy, insecticide, and bring broom to be killing the flies. It doesn't make sense. What do you do? Clean it. Make the whole place clean. Mm. The flies will go naturally. Educate the minds of our younger ones. Some of these vices will go naturally. We won't be wasting money and time and all those on them. Sincerely speaking, for me, that's the way we, that's the line we should talk.
But the educational system is still alive.
We need to revive it. It's not alive.
No, your last daughter is still at the university.
Yes.
So what are you getting from her? What kind of feelers? She's in a federal university.
Yes, a federal university. Mm-hmm. Everything comes from the family too, the background. I've disciplined my children. They don't give me headache really. They could be children, but not something that will make me go berserk over my children. I'm not disturbed about my kids, wherever they are, because they know the norms. If mommy venture here, they know now. So it's.
But these children that we're talking of were in protective, what you call protective custody.
Yes.
That is, you see,
where were the security people that are supposed to be guarding?
Let me tell you something, Christian.
Why, as a principal, where was the principal of the school? Where are the housemasters?
Where is the matron?
No, but none of them were kidnapped. Not one bullet was fired.
Exactly.
Not one bullet was fired.
No one
for the dreaded Boko Haram.
It is that was where I was saying that some of us initially we didn't believe this story.
That begs the question.
I said, where were the major? Because in my days as a brother, Mrs. Okonkwo will come even the lights goes off by 9:30. You know that woman can come by 1 a.m. It's a house is in the school premises.
Yeah.
Two matrons watching over us in school. Are you telling me that if you want to come and kidnap us, they won't raise alarm? The principal's office is in the school premises there. Some of the teachers were living in
that. Is there a conspiracy theory here?
That is where we are coming from now. I personally believe that they caught fire with the authority.
Boko Haram.
Yes. Yeah, it could be. They were bent on doing one thing. And that thing was, Jonathan must go. In anything that you want to use in removing this guy, to stain him, he has to leave.
That is
our own belief. That this man must go. Anything that will make us take him away from that seat, even if it is coming, it might be these children might not be as many as they are quoting.
They are, at least their parents came out and
said, yes. Say, I said, these are my children.
Yes.
Well, maybe we are kind of, we are not getting enough information about them in the dailies, kind of. How many papers are we going to read? This is where Uju is talking about. You have to educate people about in the ongoings of the issue. I feel the Boko Haram people cannot just go into the school break into the security, went straight to the school and told those children, these are people that are saying they are scientists now. Say, what did they tell them before they took them away?
That they are guardians or something, you know.
Somebody will just take you like that without resistance, without shouting. Even in school, sometimes you will see people just to make fun.
Yeah.
They will just shout. Everybody will be running. I see go so. And everybody will be running. So this one, did they put something in their mouth? Tira in their mouth to talk to them, that they just follow them sheepishly like that into trucks.
But 57 escaped.
And even on the road, no vigilante.
No vigilante.
No hunter.
Yeah.
Nobody.
Nobody.
No parents. They didn't have houses.
Principal did not say anything. Mbao.
Well, if this is a conspiracy, then whoever is involved, that's height of wickedness.
It's the height of it.
They can't be playing with the lives of children. That's height of it.
Hmm. It's better for me to know that my child is dead. That's a grave death.
But could they have been taken away, you know, as a negotiating tool?
But 2 years ago, 2 years down the line, are they negotiated? Have they really come out and said, okay, these children are with us. This is what we want. And the federal government refused to accede to their request? That's how you look at it. They've not come out. Like what Jonathan would say, Boko Haram, I don't know them. Let them come out. Okay, I'm the secretary of Boko Haram. Then we will talk. Because there are some certain problems that will come like this. You don't use force. You pet them to get what you want.
Yeah, it's also, you see, we're inundated in our, you know, we hear all manner of news flying.
Yeah.
You know? Recently, we heard that they also said they should be paid $50 million.
I read that one too.
You know, the truth pay. Is, so we don't
even... Let them bring the children and take $50 million. Carry your wallet go.
So we don't know which is which. Truly speaking, are these Boko Haram, are they the ones calling for this negotiation? Or it's somebody else? We don't know what is happening. That's where I think that government
is... Jonathan, remember?
Government is
free. The Bubu Jonathan said they have some group of people who are... what do you call them now?
Negotiators.
Because one Australian man flew from Austria, Australia, so that they to look genuine. He said, go get in court. At the end of the day, the thing blew on their face.
They paid money.
They paid money, I know. But the man did not collect his own now. It was there a way when they were trying to share
scheming
that?
Scheming now.
They want to scheme it. Like, hey! This is not the agreement, oh!
And nothing has happened to the man.
And nothing happened. The man entered plane here and flew back to Sydney. What type of government?
We don't tell ourselves these lies. We don't tell ourselves. We are not serious about this. We are truly speaking. We are not serious about this. What are you not telling me? I paid you money for consultancy to do something. Yeah. You didn't deliver. Please stop that.
Moment. And you didn't arrest the person.
It doesn't happen. Please. Let's stop lying to ourselves.
Okay, before we start tasking our viewers to call us on a regular number, which is, if you're calling from outside Nigeria, it is +234 816 481 8001. I'll take that again for the benefit of the unsighted. International code +234 816 481 8001. You call us to join us on the topic and discussion, the abduction of Chibok girls. Are they still alive? I'm going to ask my next question by asking you ladies, what next really for the Chibok girls?
Mm-hmm.
It's 2 years. By tomorrow, we're going to start reading 372 days.
Huge question. What next for them? Huge question. For me, I think that government should, even if government doesn't want to come clean with me, with every other person, they should come clean with the parents of the Chibok girls.
Okay.
Organize the Chibok, their parents, to reassure them. If something is happening, let them know some, even if you don't give them the full details, but carry them along. Give them hope, if there is still hope.
Okay, Uju, let's quickly go to Kaduna State and join Issa. Good morning, Issa.
Yes, good morning, Christian Ogoda.
Thank you very much. It's been a long time. We've not heard from you.
Yes. I call into your program, but the network is a problem.
All right. I understand.
Even the last time, an Issa calling from Abuja, I wanted to respond, but the network was a problem.
Okay.
So the problem about this Chibok girls was that these girls are still alive. It's just that the problem is that same politics with everything. Our government is not responsible to the people. Are more politically inclined and more politically to our political party than the people. That is a problem. Because a committed will do everything possible to secure the release of these girls. The video you just showed, I don't know if this video is recently or is an old video.
That video, the video was said to have been recorded in 2014, December 15th or December 25th, 2014.
Frankly speaking, Christian, I doubt that video that those girls, if it was not even conducted, is of the school where those girls were kidnapped. I doubt if that. You could see that these girls were very relaxed. All of them were like nothing happened. They were not looking worried. They were like relaxed as nothing happened. Some things are not very correct with that video, personally. Just a personal opinion. But to come to my point, our government should be concerned about the citizens, not the party. Before election, party. After election, the people. So this government, at this point, because I watch Alai Mohammed, I say that I cannot disclose anything. There's a negotiation going on. I doubt if there is any. But let's hope there is alive.
All right.
This is Joseph as well. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Issa. Well, Issa has reeled out a lot of issues there. First, he doesn't believe they are alive. Two, let's keep hope alive and say they are still alive. But putting the blame squarely on the doorsteps of the government. So that was part of what you were trying to, you know, tell us about what next, you know, for the Chibok girls. And you said that the parents must be carried along.
If there is hope, give them hope. If there is no hope, then reassure them. Tell them that subsequently it will happen. Well, carry them along. You see, what I detest most is the aspect of government even behaving as if they are disturbing them. For goodness sake, why did we vote in? I mean,
why do you have a government?
Why do you have a government? Government is a continuum. It doesn't matter if it happened in the last regime. Yes. The most important thing is now we are.
Even if the last regime was a failure in this area, now you are there. But everybody has acknowledged the fact that you've dealt a serious blow to the Boko Haram insurgents. But where are the girls?
So please, and as far as I'm concerned, if we don't rescue these girls or get information, tangible information, it's a slap on our faces, on all of us, all of our faces.
If you ask me, what next?
Okay, let's quickly speak to Peter. It's been a long, long time again. Good morning, Peter.
Hello, good morning.
How are you? Hello, Peter.
Good morning.
All right, thanks for joining us. I said it's been quite a while.
Yeah, I've been away for some time now.
All right, okay. Nice to have you back contributing on Core Digest.
Thank you. Greetings to my your guest.
All right. He's saying good morning to
good
you.
Good morning, Peter.
Well, about the people's guest issue, it's a pity that the government of this land used this girl for a sacrifice, the way I can put it. Because this girl they are used to play politics. Because this started from the local government to the state. Because when you think about this Boko Haram issue, that education is an abomination and so, the state government and the local government went to help such examination without protection. And it's a pity, even when this thing was happening, very distressed the government and the opposition never wants to put their hands together to fight this thing at that early time. And 2 years down the line, nobody should hope that these girls, even though they were alive, they were not in Nigeria, even though they are alive, because there is no safe haven for Islamists to keep them. But now, even though they are alive, a lot of them have gone outside the shore of this country. So some safe haven for Islamists where they can be. Only few of them you can find here. And the few of them you can find them together. They were either in one house or the other. There's no way you can find these girls together. Most of them, if they were alive, most of them were outside this country. Mm. So long from Chad, Libya, Mauritania, Mali, and so on. Because this fight for this Islamists is not for Nigeria alone. Their help, their weapons come from that area. It's a pity. And the government, they are not carrying us along. They are not telling us the fact about these girls. It's a pity that these girls are done this way. They use them for election and the rest of the thing. Blame game. Because when this thing happens, even the then government should not believe that it happened really. Before they start realizing, before they start believing that it happened, it's getting late. Because from the state government there, the person that's supposed to be held responsible is the state governor of that particular state. And the principal of that school and the rest, that the people that are supposed to stand, ask these people questions, tell us, listen, let's hear from them, because a lot of people are supposed to stand, ask questions, hear from them. In the television, people will be watching, not hearsay. What people will be watching, listen from them, from the sources, the megad, this is one megad of school to guide 300 and something girls, the megad will be there asking questions. Here, it's a pity with human lives they are just in Nigeria. Worth nothing. It's a pity. And girls for that matter, how rich is there, we are boys, even. But girls to that, it's a pity.
The boys,
I don't know. We are short of words about it.
All right, Peter. Thank you very much. It's indeed a pity. What's the name of another government secondary school in Yobe where over 60 of the boys, you know, had earlier been killed by Boko Haram that same year? I think it was in 2014 or so, and the rest.
2014.
Yeah, this is a very dastardly organization and acts that they carry out, and the rest. And sometimes you probably wouldn't want to blame the governor of Kaduna State, then Rufai, that is trying to introduce a religious bill into the state so that some of these rascalities, you know,
will be tamed.
Yeah, you know. Although rights activists like Uju are saying no, the constitution guarantees,
exactly, for
you know,
sake.
It guarantees.
The constitution is the most important document in this nation. Mm. Whatever it is you want to do, must comply, must be in line with the constitution. If it goes contrary to the constitution, there's a problem. I will never toe that line. I won't agree with you. It doesn't matter what the purpose is. If you have an issue with the constitution, move for the constitution to be amended. Then let's do whatever it is we want to do. Mm-hmm. But once it runs contrary to the constitution, I have an issue. It doesn't matter who's involved. Sincerely speaking.
Please, Christian.
Go on.
Let me roll back again. In that video. That guy was being interviewed in Hausa. Why?
Okay. Maybe I think we should again, for the benefit of some of our viewers and the rest, let's get straight this thing. We take that video again, that exclusive video from cable news network CNN that we got. Let's hear, you know, some of the kidnapped people talk.
And this girls
lined up against a yellow wall, 15 girls, only their faces showing. An off-camera voice asks each girl, "What's your name?" Is that the name your parents recognize? Where were you taken from, the voice asks. Chibok school, and the date they say is the 25th of December, 2015. This video was obtained by CNN from a person close to the negotiations to get these girls released. For the parents, it's finally a glimmer of hope these girls are still alive. Two years ago, we met Mary Ashaya, Rifkatu Ayuba, and Yala Galang on our visit to Chibok after the abduction of their daughters and more than 200 other girls. We asked them if they recognize any of the girls in the video. They lean closer. Another girl is identified, Hawa. One by one, they name all 15 girls. But one mother, Yala, realizes her daughter isn't there. The off-camera voice asking the questions is familiar to CNN as that of Boko Haram spokesman Abu Zinara. A source close to negotiations between Boko Haram and the Nigerian government said the video was provided by the terror group as an asked-for show of good faith. Nigeria's information minister told CNN they have received the video, but are still reviewing it.
If you study the video, you find that the questions were asked in a rather very controlled environment. Then we were a bit concerned, too, that after 2 years in captivity, the girls in the video were under no stress whatsoever. There has been little or no transformation to their physical appearance.
Is your government negotiating with Boko Haram for the release of these girls?
Well, there are ongoing talks. We cannot ignore offers. We cannot ignore leads. But of course, many of these investigations cannot be disclosed, you know, openly, because it could also endanger, you know, the negotiations.
We took the video to a classmate of the Chibok girls. She'd been at home with family the day the other girls were kidnapped. For her safety, we're not showing her face and not using her name. She told us there's no doubt these are some of her kidnapped classmates.
These two were prefects. Watching the video, I'm reminded of how we used to play together, how we used to do chores, do our homework.
She says seeing her friends again will likely give her nightmares.
Sometimes still, if I hear news about them, I have bad dreams and I wake up crying.
The video ends with a girl addressing the camera with a message to the Nigerian government. "We are all well," she says pointedly, perhaps suggesting girls not seen in this video. She then delivers what sounds like a scripted plea, urging the Nigerian government to fulfill unspecified promises. For the mothers of these girls rapidly becoming women far from home, the video is overwhelming. They say they just want someone to bring their daughters home. Nemal Bagir, CNN, Maiduguri, Nigeria.
I'm caught wrapped in that too. So, would you? This were. All right. This were. Students about writing physics examinations. Is it the indoctrination now that has made them, by their abductors, not to speak English anymore? Because we all know what the meaning of Boko Haram means.
Excuse me. Christian, I must say something about that. You know, I don't want to overflow the issue of education. The truth is, even in Nigeria of today, you'll be amazed when you go to a whole lot of government schools. Even some people in secondary schools can't write their names, can't speak good
English. In English language.
Yes, can't speak good English, can't make correct sentences in English. Especially, well, some of my friends are served in the north.
Let's just quickly join, go over to ABBA, the Commercial Nerve Center of the Southeast, to join Sunday. Good morning, Sunday.
Yeah, good morning, my brother. Good morning.
Thank you very much. So,
this Chibok issue, how can they come to a school and pick up 300 and something girls? How many trucks did they come with in that school? How many trucks?
Well,
okay, when you watch the video, the girls are just smiling when they're interviewing them. I hope you know what I'm saying.
Go on.
Yes. The guys who are smiling, they're not as if anything happens. This is just a threat to remove the former president, Jonathan. That's all. And they have achieved their aim. This all this is that I'm talking just to waste time.
But Sunday, Sunday.
If there's anything that the government will do for them, they will do it for them with the whole fund.
Sunday,
there's nothing serious about all this issue.
Okay. I was just going to ask Sunday, if the aim of abducting those girls was to remove President Jonathan, why, after getting rid of President Jonathan, why have they not returned the girls? All right, I'd lost Sunday there putting that question, but let's look at it. You know, some of you have looked at the political coloration about it. So let's put it succinctly. President Jonathan is no longer president. The girls, some people are saying, some theorists are saying that they were captured in order to use it as a political weapon to smear, you know, the character and government of President Jonathan. It's out of the way now. So why haven't the girls been brought back 2 years after? So what are we saying here?
That is where some people are being called Thomas. Some didn't believe it, that they took any children from that school. It was just like that. You listen to some of them, they will tell you it's a scam. They're just formulating stories. So some people don't believe that up till tomorrow that there's anything called Chibok girls.
But
they will tell you that they pay some crying. What do you call them?
To pay people to cry.
To come and cry. To come and professional whalers. Hey, would you try? They will say they will go and bring professional.
I think everything about Nigeria is willing whalers now.
They will say go and bring professional whalers to come and cry. This and that, because that was what made me to ask that question. I said, a child that is doing physics should be able to speak very good English. Why are you interviewing the child with a native language?
Even the one that escaped, why is she being interviewed in Hausa or in
Kenuri? So when you tell me that you go to the north, it doesn't mean if you go to north, they don't speak English in the government schools there. Speak Hausa.
Moving to rural areas in Nigeria. Rural areas.
Well, some of us are from rural area.
If your Delta rural area is pidgin English that you speak, even your mother or grandmother of 100 years can say pidgin.
I grew up in Onitsha. When I was in primary 3, I was already borrowing books from the school library. So we won't consider Onitsha a rural area. go to remote areas in Nigeria, you'll be shocked what you see. I'm telling you the truth.
So the teachers will be speaking the vernacular?
They teach them, yes. For instance, you want to teach them English language, you use that the native language to teach them English.
But that's, they are more intelligent. Because that was an experiment started at the then University of Ife, now OAU, by the late Professor Babs Fafunwa. You understand, and you know, in the education faculty there. Okay, let's cross over to Cross River, and another Sunday is there. Good morning, Sunday.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Yeah, thank you, and thanks for joining us. Tell us, the Chibok girls 2 years after, are they still alive?
Well, I would say that this issue is a political issue, because the thing has really hung on the people that made the initial plan that after the election there will be a release of the girl. But what we are seeing is, as if the game plan did not work out well with them again. That's why they are talking about negotiating. So it's all about politics. You can't tell me that a girl, about 300 and something, girls will be abducted one day. No security in the school. No community within there that will make any noise. The first truck left. The second truck left. And we continue to believe that these girls were abducted. My brother, I have not seen any light on that. So it's all about politics. They should come out and tell us.
Sunday, how about their mothers, the people crying every day, recognizing that these are our children? Are they hired to play the role of mothers or criers or wailers, like my guests here have said? Hello, Sunday?
Yes, I think if you weigh those women that do cry, you cannot see more than 10 or 15 numbers of women crying together. We have not seen a situation whereby we see a bundlement of about 300 families crying. If 300 families, father and mother, will wake up and say they want to cry for their children, you are going to see about 600 or above people. But you are seeing 10 women in the television screen, 20 women gathering, and their mention and their pattern of crying is a fake crying. Somebody will just cry and roll in the ground after the video coverage that will be landed. So, I have not seen any sincerity in them, my brother.
All right. Thank you very much, Sunday. If he, you
that's
just...
That's another dimension.
Would you?
Well...
Let's even say 200 girls. And, okay, let's say no, maybe let's say some will be... you have a few widows and widowers amongst them. So let's just say 150 parents, you know, those who are still complete as husband and wife. So you're talking of 300 of them coming to cry and the rest in one gathering.
You know, Christian, it's neither here nor there. It beats my imagination as well. But the truth is, you know, they have an association of parents, of Chibok girls' parents. You know they do. And they have a chairman. So I'm thinking, for me, that's why I'm wondering. I mean, if this is all politics, are you also saying that they bought, okay, yes, it's possible they bought the women, that means they bought even the man, they bought other parents that members of that association? For me, I don't think so.
It doesn't add up.
Yes, it doesn't. It doesn't. And even to say that the girls, in their interview, they were all we only saw their faces. We didn't see their bodies. We don't know that they've emaciated. You can't tell by the faces. No, it's possible. You can't tell by the faces. That's number one. And then number two, some of the girls were not smiling. And then remember that we were trying a video. What if somebody was pointing a gun at them that we did not see? If you don't smile, we're going to shoot you. Mm-hmm. And then they'll put up their best act. Mm-hmm. It's possible.
There are just a lot of, scenarios surrounding the
Chibok
whole
issue. Too many stories, too many predictions, too many
There was a time the government, the governor of Borno State, you know, let me just say the government, went and was given the parents money as a kind of compensation.
He gave them money, or is it was it not Jonathan's regime that he gave them money
to go back? No, it's not about the state governor.
I didn't read about that. Did you?
The state governor? No, I'm not aware of that.
I'm not aware that he gave them.
Maybe it was just to alleviate their suffering.
Suffering, anyway.
Not like a compensation. How do you compensate one for a child that you said you're still looking for? I'm sure it was just to alleviate their suffering. I'm sure of that. I strongly believe that
he did not, that he's paying for the life of those children.
Yeah.
But he didn't do well.
Or paying for the failure of government.
Like
you said, sincerely speaking, I think the parents of Chibok girls should go to court.
After two years, what next? Go to court.
Sincerely speaking, if they're not
about 700 or something days, you can't produce my child, I will sue you.
Okay, let's quickly join Segun from Ekiti State. Good morning, Segun.
Good morning, sir.
Thank you very much for joining us. You're probably going to be our last caller for the day, so be brief.
Okay. Let me quickly just react to what the two persons that come from Aba and Kosiva.
Yeah.
Well, just like my governor said, every Nigerian who they are aware that all this issue of Chibok is a crap. Buhari should come out and tell Nigerians exactly what they know about the Chibok thing. There is no abduction anywhere, and by the time we watch this video, we will all see those girls. There is no any analysis from any security man who is intelligent to tell that this girl is looking at with this posture and this psychological looking anywhere traumatized in any way. This is our camp. So Buhari should come out and tell Nigerians what he know and deflect the mother man's heart about these girls in the first place. And why they were just trying to use this thing as a come up to beat Nigeria, perhaps they were going to use it to advance amnesty to Boko Haram. Using this keyboard as an excuse. The only thing I can read from it, the government rightly said some time ago, there is nothing like a question anyway. This is a just men's camp. So Bradley is responsible for all these things, and we know all. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Segun from Ekiti State. I find that out of place Segun's accusations, you know, against the president, because he's a president that went to Saudi Arabia and Qatar and the rest and signed, you know, a kind of bilateral cooperation in fighting terrorists that we know is dotted the whole of the Middle East and the rest, and even entering Europe now, to war against the kind of situation that we have here. Would you now say is like an accomplice or a sympathizer of such a terrorist group?
Well, Christian, it also begs, in fact, there are a whole lot of issues. This one also begs the question, because now in the Middle East, have they succeeded
in the war they are fighting? Terrorism.
Did they succeed or have they succeeded?
Mm-hmm.
So
there's no way in the anywhere terrorism, sprouts from that you succeed in wiping it out.
Okay,
completely.
But even if you,
you reduce it to the barest minimum.
So
in the last 2 weeks, fortnight, if not more, we've not heard of any, IED exploding. We've not heard of suicide bombing. So which means they
in
are
Nigeria.
In Nigeria. So which means they have been.
What we're heading is headsmen, Abi. Fulani headsmen.
Is the Fulani headsmen now
is
that
them killing?
Yeah.
Well, Christian, if you say so,
If, like what Segun is saying, you know, during that, I think 2014 or 2013, this same president came out to say a blast on Boko Haram is a blast to the north. He said it. I think during the Yejirika's
time as chief of army staff.
Chief of army staff. That if you kill any Boko Haram, they are killing the North. So you wouldn't blame Shegun calling from Ekiti. That is to tell the world what he knows about it. So sometimes you have to be very careful with your tolerances. Because they read minutes to it. A whole former general will come to the air and say a blast on a Boko Haram is a blast to the North. Then you are not, you have not won any election. It was, at, I think it was at the 2012 or 13 that he made that statement. Now you are there now. You promised people that you are going to bring these people in within 2 weeks. Okay, we didn't give you 2 weeks. We're giving you 1 year. Where are those guys? And expect them not to say, you know something about it. We don't believe Nigerians.
So ladies, in rounding up, what do I ask? Is it the way forward? But
about the way forward.
It's just how to get the girls back.
Is to, if you can, 2 years is enough for government to bring those girls out. If you don't bring them out, I will advise people like Uju who are labor practitioners and activists, they should organize lawyers for those parents. Let them come out for people to see them, and they sue the state government, sue the federal government. Primarily, they have not done their job, that is the government. The government would have, you know, secured the lives of those children. Before anything, we are not talking about properties. Life.
Yeah.
That's what we are talking about. And since you cannot secure it, you know, something, you have to start something to teach government lessons. Because sometimes this is our government, they take us, you know,
for granted
that what would they do, but one person, one illiterate from that Chibok can change the face of
government responsibility to citizens.
And you, the only thing you can do is to help them. If those were the parents of those girls I'm seeing, those women are real pure farmers.
Yeah.
They don't know anything. Then you people that know should bring them in. Sacrifice for them. Don't charge them. Face government. Like my brother that lives in the UK. He's another website to sue government, and they're the winner.
Yes, if I tend to agree with you there that government failed in its duty, yes. And it is still failing.
It is. They are still failing.
Because they have done so much even since after.
By the time they sue them, they will stand up.
But then I'm also thinking that really, if the international community wants to help us, and they said that they saw this girl somewhere. Please let them just get in there. They are saying they want to reduce casualty. I'm sure some of those girls have died by now.
No.
You don't think so?
Yes.
Some of them would have died.
Yes.
So at least even if we rescue 100 or 50 or 100, let's rescue them and know that we rescue these ones. Let's take every step that we should take.
Mm-hmm.
Because of these ones, we've been waiting since for the past 3 years. Oh, we don't want to reduce the number of casualties. Oh, we don't want to take them by force. We don't want to do. It doesn't make sense.
Bring anymore. Them out by force.
2 years down the line, please. Even if it's 50.
Have you forgotten India? What do you call it? Kampala, whatever.
Entebbe.
Go and bring them by force.
If it's 100, we say let's.
Let us bring the 100. Exactly. Let us see.
Exactly. Let's see them. Instead of just telling us, you know, I mean, don't postpone the evil day. There's going to be an evil day. Let it be today.
Today.
And today, not an evil day, today the second anniversary of the kidnap, abduction of the Chibok girls by the dreaded Boko Haram. Where are they? Are they still alive? A lot of theories have been conjured up about the whereabouts of those girls. Some have said they should forget them, they are gone forever. Some are still keeping hope alive. The government of the day says they are optimistic that they will bring back those girls alive. Your prayers, our prayers, is pointed at the same direction. Bring back our girls alive. Thank you very much for being part of today's special edition of Core Digest. Ifeoma Isehi. Yeah, she's a social commentator. I hope you'll find time again to be part of this place, so yeah, that your fiery nature on the House of Integrity you can bring to bear here.
Not only House of Integrity.
All right. But you have the Corp Digest platform now. All right. Yes, thank you very much, Ife.
Thank you.
And Barrister Uju Peace Okeke, she's an activist, very gender sensitive, and a legal practitioner. Thanks for making it to our studios.
You're welcome. And,
and I'm looking forward to seeing you sometime again. I must always make it an admix, and not just putting the men here alone. You know, for once, I'm surrounded by a bevy of beauties.
For you.
Absolutely. All right, thanks very much. A big thank you to all the production hands, the transmission director, the chief cameraman, and the guys on the audio and on the telephone. My name is Christian Nogodo. See you for the last edition of Core Digest tomorrow. Thanks for watching, and bye-bye.
Is it what Chrissy?
Or talk Chrissy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, tribal looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is, that will bring our military to the support. I said, oh, help
on
me.
On Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.